Thank you to Blinkist for supporting PBS. How do you see the unseeable? How do you explore the inescapable? Our cleverest astronomers have figured out ways to catch light that skims the very edge of black holes. Let's find out what they learned. A few weeks ago, a story made the rounds of pop-sci media proclaiming for the first time that light had been detected from behind a black hole. The reports were about a paper that claimed to have seen X-rays that came not from inside a black hole, but from the backside of a black hole. Now, this is obviously cool stuff. I mean, really, anything new with black holes captures the public attention. But this result is cool in ways that most people aren't aware, and it brought us closer to a goal that I have been personally striving for years. Trying to understand what happens in the vicinity of the largest black holes in the universe. I thought it would be worth doing a Spacetime Journal Club on the Nature paper by Wilkins, Gallo, Costantini, Brandt and Blandford so that I get to talk about my favourite subject in the universe. Now, you might remember the picture of the black hole captured by the Event Horizon Telescope. We talked about this soon after it came out, but to remind you, here we have radio light from charged particles whirling around the black hole, and the more recent version of this in polarized light shows the grain of the magnetic field right near the black hole's edge. This image was produced through a Herculean effort, a team of hundreds of scientists and engineers synthesizing data from radio telescopes across the globe. They stitched the image together using the very latest machine learning techniques to achieve an image resolution equivalent to a telescope the size of the planet Earth. All very impressive, very state-of-the-art, but the thing I love about the result we're discussing today is its simple elegance. We've been using the same technique for decades to understand quasars. This method doesn't need an international team or a planet-sized telescope. It can be done with a single ordinary scope and one astronomer with lots of patience. The technique is reverberation mapping, in which we watch as a flare of light from a violent event near a black hole radiates and reflects, reverberates its way through the complex structure of a quasar. When that light reaches us, many millions of light years away, it's still imprinted with a wealth of information about the monster that it escaped. Reverberation mapping is all about untangling that information. We do this by watching how the spectrum of the quasar changes over the time. A spectrum, by the way, is what you get when you split light into its component colors or wavelengths. So basically, you watch the quasar, which is just a faint point of light on the sky, and stretch it into an even fainter flickering rainbow, and then try to pull from that the full 3D map of the quasar. To understand exactly how astrophysicists do this, I'm going to take you on a journey. We're going to follow a flare from its origin deep in the belly of the beast, uncomfortably close to the supermassive black hole. Supermassive, by the way, is the actual technical term for the largest black holes in the universe, anything more than a million or so times the mass of the Sun. These things are pretty much only found in the very centers of galaxies, and pretty much every decent-sized galaxy has one of these at their center. They are mostly dark, except when a bunch of gas shows up in the galactic core. Then you get this gigantic whirlpool of searing plasma screaming around the black hole, aka an accretion disk, and switching on the quasar. Quasars are not what you'd call stable. They sputter and flare with violent events, for example, as dense clumps of gas hit the center, or magnetic instabilities shake things up. However it happens, when a flare is generated near the black hole, it expands outwards, and it causes a lot of trouble along the way. The expanding shell first rips across the surface of the accretion disk, causing different parts of the disk to brighten. First the shorter wavelength, which corresponds to the hot inner disk, then to longer wavelengths of the cooler outer regions. The flare then continues outwards and upwards. Although it's energetic, the accretion disk is relatively well behaved, at least compared to the wild stuff all around it. A maelstrom of lower density gas rages above and below and beyond the accretion disk. That gas is accelerated by a combination of the incredible gravitational field of the black hole and the continuous blaze of high-energy radiation from the inner accretion disk. It can be driven to up to 10% or more of the speed of light. Pockets of gas within this flow are somehow shielded, and so that gas could cool down a bit. This gas starts to glow in a different way, not from heat, but from the motion of electrons between their atomic energy levels. This allows the maelstrom to reprocess some of the light of the accretion disk so that it shines bright in very specific colors depending on what atoms are present. In a normal spectrum, we see light from these electron transitions as sharp spikes at specific wavelengths, what we call emission lines. But in a quasar, the gas is moving fast, and that motion shifts the wavelengths of light as we see it. Now, we've all experienced this Doppler shift when the sound waves of an ambulance siren shift between higher and lower pitch as it passes us on the street. In the case of the quasar's emission lines, gas is moving towards us and away from us at many different speeds. The sharp emission lines get shifted to many different degrees and add together to produce the classic broad emission lines, perhaps the most striking feature of the quasar spectrum, and one that confused the hell out of astronomers who first saw them. And honestly, it's been confusing us ever since. From the Doppler shift, we can tell that the gas is moving fast, but that doesn't tell us what drives the gas. Is this stuff that's pouring towards the black hole, or orbiting it, or being blasted out by the crazy radiation from the accretion disk? Now, this is where reverberation mapping can be the most powerful. The light from this gas is ultimately powered by the light from the accretion disk. So when our expanding shell of light rips through this gas, the broad lines get supercharged, but in a complicated way. First the gas near the center brightens, then the gas further out. At the same time, the response of the gas on the far side of the quasar is slower than the gas on the near side because the far side's light has to travel further to get to us. Let's look at a simplistic example. Two totally different scenarios for how gas might be moving. One, it's pouring in, rivers of gas dragged down by the black hole's gravity. And two, it's being blasted out, riding the flow of radiation from the inner accretion disk. Either of these scenarios could produce the same Doppler-broadened emission lines, but reverberation mapping can tell between them. Consider case one. If gas is pouring in, then it's accelerating, moving fastest towards the center. This means this extreme velocity gas, the far ends of the broad line, should respond first as our flare reverberates out. Also, in this scenario, the gas on the far side of the black hole is moving towards the black hole and so towards us. Its light is blue shifted to shorter wavelengths. That gas responds late to the flare because the light has to take this roundabout journey. Meanwhile, the gas closer to us is actually moving away from us as it falls towards the black hole. It's red shifted to longer wavelengths and it responds before the blue shifted light. So in the inflow model, the quickest response is for the red side of the emission line, the slowest for the blue side. It's exactly the opposite for case two. If gas is being blasted out, then the gas accelerates outwards, so we expect the faster moving gas to respond later than the slow gas. And now the gas on the far side of the black hole is moving away, while the gas on our side is moving towards us. So the red shifted gas responds after the blue shifted gas. Oh, and I forgot the third option. Maybe the gas is swirling around in a giant tornado above the accretion disk. In that case, inner gas is moving faster, like in the infall case, but now the red and blue sides should respond at roughly the same time. Reverberation mapping has helped us tell between these three scenarios. Well, sort of, anyway. It turns out that all three types of motion are seen in different quasars. The emerging picture is that gas falls in along some trajectories but then gets lifted up from the accretion disk by the blazing radiation of the inner disk into a vortex, and then it's blasted outwards. That's about as far as we've got with the broad line tornado. It's really, really hard to do this stuff because it takes years for big, powerful quasars to finish responding to a flare in the core. Over the next decades, things will get better as new telescopes like the Vera Rubin Observatory come online. We'll be able to watch millions of quasars do their thing all at the same time. Okay, it's time we got back to the discovery that started our little journey, the light that was detected from behind a black hole. The events described in the paper happened extremely close to a relatively nearby supermassive black hole. The object is I-Zwicky-1, a so-called Seyfert galaxy, which is like a mini quasar, this one around 100 million light years away. Near the black hole, there are sources of light that I haven't mentioned yet. The intense radiation in this region strips almost all atoms of their electrons. That leads to a haze of high-energy electrons surrounding the black hole. As light from the accretion disk passes through this haze, it gains energy from the electrons, boosting it all the way up to X-ray energies. This is the X-ray corona. We also have winds of matter flowing at incredible speeds, but this close to the black hole, only the heaviest elements, like iron, can hold on to any of their electrons. We see that iron because it shines at very specific X-ray wavelengths. This is the iron K alpha line. So, here's what happened. The X-ray corona flared bright, probably in a small region right above the black hole. That light then spread in all directions, some traveling straight towards us, some reflected off the disk in our direction, but some also reflected off the disk on the opposite side of the black hole. And a portion of that light was then grabbed by the black hole's gravitational field and slung right back around towards us, and magnified in the process. It was, as we say, gravitationally lensed. These three paths were apparent in the three distinct phases of the flare. They were also able to see that there was a difference in the response of the different parts of the iron line. The blue side varied before the red side, and we talked about how this suggests an outflow. We have other reasons to think that this iron-laced wind also has a very powerful rotational component. So it looks like we're seeing an expanding vortex of stuff that just narrowly escaped being sucked into the black hole. The paper goes into a lot more detail than this, lots of good stuff like measuring the mass of the black hole, 30 million suns, to verifying Einstein's general theory of relativity. So you can check out the links in the description for more details. After decades of practice and inventing better and better telescopes, we are starting to get good at this game. I just love it when we can map the space around black holes by watching flickering points of light on the sky, and in that flickering, reconstruct how light reverberates around the most extreme regions of space-time. We'd like to thank Blinkist for supporting PBS. It can be hard to find time to sit down and read a whole book, but now you can in the blink of an eye. Blinkist is an app that produces key takeaways from thousands of nonfiction books and condenses them into 15 minutes that you can either read or listen to. Blinkist has an array of categories from the science of quantum mechanics to philosophy to futurism. For more information and a Blinkist limited trial, please go to the link in the description. Today we're covering comments from the last two episodes. First was the Everett Wheeler telephone, where we explored how to send messages across the quantum multiverse, and then the episode on how vacuum decay could destroy the universe. Or universes, if the ideas of the first episode are right. Mark VA wonders whether faster-than-light communication methods might be detectable from great distances, as in could we see the effects of FTL communication from distant alien civilizations? Well, warp fields are supposed to blast an intense beam of radiation ahead of them when they come out of warp, which could potentially be seen if they were pointed at us. Some people have proposed that this is what gamma ray bursts might be. Now, those people are dead wrong, because it would mean that the number of FTL-capable civilizations in the galaxy would have to be enormous for the numbers to work out. And that's for actual FTL travel. For communication, the warp bubble can be much, much smaller, so we probably wouldn't be able to observe those. The same with entanglement-based communication. The way we'd most likely detect FTL activity is because FTL-capable civilizations shouldn't have any problem coming to visit us, which they haven't, so there's some evidence right there. Karina makes a similar style of argument, saying that this crazy idea just makes it even more convincing that Schrödinger's equation is linear. In other words, if the non-linearity of the Schrödinger equation allows these paradox-generating phenomena, then we can take that as evidence against that non-linearity. And honestly, I think that's the most useful takeaway from Polchinski and Weinberg's work. Moritz von Schweinitz and TBE Price both commented that vacuum decay scenarios sound a lot like the Big Bang, what with it producing an expanding bubble full of energetic particles. Well, it's an excellent observation. In fact, cosmic inflation, the event that many physicists thought put the bang in the Big Bang, is a type of vacuum decay. Some scalar field that may or may not have been the Higgs field is thought to have dropped from a much higher value into a stable minimum. The difference is that in the pre-inflation universe, space was expanding exponentially quickly due to the high value of that field. That means a new vacuum decay event now wouldn't yield a universe whose interior was expanding quickly in the sense of particles racing apart from each other. You can look at our past episodes on inflation for all of the gory details. Dr. Patrick Bryant from Carnegie Mellon University popped into the comment section and told us a little about his work using the Large Hadron Collider to try to map the shape of the Higgs potential by looking at Higgs boson pair production. Dr. Bryant answered one question that I also had. How big does the vacuum decay bubble need to be in order to propagate? If it's too small, it'll collapse in on itself. Well, actually, Dr. Bryant didn't know the full answer, but he tells us that it depends on the energy difference between the false and true vacuum. Presumably, the bigger the difference, the smaller the bubble needs to be. But I would also imagine that the bigger the energy difference, the less probability of the field tunneling to the true minimum. So maybe those cancel out? Actually, I'm just making stuff up now. Dr. Bryant, if you wouldn't mind hurrying up with mapping the Higgs potential so we know the answer to this, that'd be great. You mentioned that you probably need a bigger collider to do that properly. Cool, let's do it. Triple Ale quips, if we figure out how to send messages backwards in time, I'll make sure I'm the first to know. Well, if I figure out how to send messages backwards in time, I'll warn myself not to do video intros in which I say I'm going to send messages between universes in a Scottish accent. Mostly because everyone thought it was a Russian accent, except the Scots, who just thought it was really, really bad. But to that I answer, you people have no idea what Scottish accents sound like in parallel universes. That accent was as unfalsifiable as the many worlds interpretation. So there.